Good evening, everybody, and thanks for spending your Wednesday night here with us at Southern Rounds Live. We got a great lineup here. We got Wil Nance, Derik Hultquist in the studio, and I thought if those two monsters were going to get up here and play songs, I thought I might jump in on this round too. So we're going to have a good old time tonight. But real quickly, for anybody who's new tuning in, the purpose of Southern Rounds, our whole mission was to take the Nashville songwriter round that happens every night and all over the place here in Nashville, out on the road into your towns, into your cities, into your theaters and honky tonks. And, you know, like a lot of other things, we had to push pause on that and decided we'd try to come in here right into your home in the least creepy way possible. So we appreciate you guys joining us here tonight. And I'm going to turn it over right now to my brother from East Tennessee, Mr. Derik Hultquist. How you doing, man?
I'm good.
Don't be too excited to be down here now.
Yeah. No, you know, this is convenient. This is the first time that somebody said to go somewhere, and it was down the street. I live out here, out this way.
So. Oh, nice.
It worked out well for me.
We did that on purpose, just for you, man.
I appreciate it.
Well, man, I want to hear a little bit more about your journey to Nashville at some point in time. But first, this first round, I think I'd just like to hear a song, man. What are you going to play for us?
This is a tune. It's called Joan of Arc. From her cigarette stains to her 90s bangs, she was 20 years behind. And she looked like hell when that pillar fell and that bridge snapped its line. In a little town where the world slows down, I know the reason why. That was Joan of Arc who dragged her heart across that great divide. At the stop and go, Terry told her so, said they'd published a report. Said that county line weren't hard to find, it was hard to get over. Well, she just laughed a bit and took a chance and headed out the door. Unbeknownst to Joan, who was on her phone, the road weren't paved no more. And with every bend, a little wind pushed out a little doubt. Till all she had was a Fritos bag and about 2,000 pounds. Handmade steel like a Detroit shield, it was dangerous in style. For old concrete doesn't need a reason to give out. Let's back it up, you've heard enough about that worn out road. Let's take it back to the woman that young Joan was named for. See, her mama knew that Joan would do exactly as she chose. So she named her for that French broad show Joan was stubborn to. And on that fateful day, someone had to say, Joan, you're no good. Never done a single thing for anyone you should. And Joan was mad as hell, but of course she felt that very same thought. For the truth it hurts, and those dirty words, they're the worst of all. So as she found that curve, her last words were, I'm gonna make a change. She was gonna spend the weekend with her mama and behave. But she never made their dinner date, and that's the way it goes. And you could smell the flame as Joan became one with her clothes. From her cigarette stains to her 90s bangs, she was 20 years behind. And And she looked like hell when that pillar fell and that bridge snapped its line. In a little town where the world slows down, I know the reason why. That was Joan of Arc who dragged her heart across that great divide.
Yeah, man. That's beautiful.
Thank you.
Wow. That's good stuff, y'all. That's Derik Hultquist. We're going to hear a little bit more about him here in just a little bit and a few more songs. But right now, we're going to move it over to a Southern Rounds veteran here. Mr. Wil Nance is in the building. How you doing tonight, brother?
I'm good, Dave. Thanks.
Well, we appreciate you being here. Appreciate you coming back. I mean, if nothing else, that if Kevin Mack didn't scare you away, then... I said, you must be a tough hombre then.
I love OK Mac, man.
We do
he
too,
don't
man.
Scare That's good to be back. Good to be anywhere.
We appreciate it. Yeah, I hear that, man. Well, tell us a little bit about what you're going to play here, if you don't mind.
All right. I'll do this for all the George Strait fans. I know there's still some George Strait fans out there. And it's funny, this song, I wrote this song with my buddy Steve Williams and Cherie Austin. And I had this idea for the song, and I got to give credit to Steve. We tried to write this for about a year, and I was hating where it was going. And he would not let me not write this idea. So he kept bringing it up at every writing session. Finally, we trashed everything we had, and we wrote this song. And George Strait cut it. And it's funny, People Magazine did a review on the record, and I laughed when I read this. It said, any middle-aged man can relate to this. I laughed. I said, that's great. I'm writing them for the 50-year-olds, and Taylor Swift's writing them for the 14-year-olds at the time. I think my son was like 20 years old when this song came out. He goes, Dad, I get that song. You don't got to be 50 to get that song. So anyway, here you go. Been down the road to work and back. Been in what I thought was love a few times. But every once in a while, I stop and ask, where have I been all my life? These days, broccoli don't taste so bad, and neither does swallowing my pride. I'm agreeing more and more with my old man. Where have I been all my life? Yeah, some years are clear, some a little blurry. Man, how they fly by. Mom and Dad sure got old in a hurry. Where have I been all my life? Been learning that forgiveness is as much for myself as it is for the other guy. And I read the good book these days and believe it. Where have I been all my life? Some years are clear, some a little blurry. Man, how they fly by. Mom and Dad sure got old in a hurry. Where have I been all my life? I heard What a Wonderful World by Louis Armstrong. It brought a tear to my eye. After all these years, I finally get that song. Where have I been all my life?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Well, I definitely blew it in figuring out where to sit in this round and where to come in. We got the hit makers out here playing right before you, and I ain't got a hit one to throw at the wall, but we're going to try anyway. But, Will, thank you, man. That's a beautiful song. Oh, it always thanks, has been, man. Love hearing you play it. And we want to, you know, obviously hear more about your journey and successes as the evening goes along. I'm going to pick a song now. I was trying to figure out what to play tonight, honestly. And I think that while Will talked about how they, you know, you guys tried to write that song for like a year, you mentioned, and sometimes it goes that way. You know, sometimes you dig in and it takes that much time really to just hit on that thing that works.
Trying to figure out how to write it where everybody gets it, you know.
Yeah, totally. And then sometimes you're driving your family to Disney World in the dark of night and everyone's asleep and you're driving the car listening to Jerry Reed thinking, wonder what happened to all those swamp animals in Amos Moses. And you just start speaking weird stuff into your phone. And then you get out on the road with a guy named Drake White writing and playing and have a night off and finish a song in Fort Worth, Texas that you started on the way to Disney World. Anyhow, this is a song called Frog and Toad. Mr. Frog and Mr. Toad, they were sitting on the edge of the pond. And along came Lola, the voodoo witch, waving round her magic wand. Said I lost a prince round here somewhere, now I'm kissing every frog I can. And the ones that don't turn to royalty gonna wind up in the frying pan. Then along came a spider who sat down beside her, gnawing on a cricket leg. Said, listen here, Lola, cause I done told you that old frog prince was dead. He was hopping around, grinning up at me, eating up all the flies. And I was just about to cuss him when the alligator kissed his ass goodbye. You gonna be the frog prince, don't you eat the spider's flies. His best friend is the old alligator and he got hungry eyes. And if you're the gator, be careful, brother, which royal frog you choose. Cause if your lunch is love, man, she's gonna turn you into shoes. Well, that spider laughed and Lola cried and Frog and Toad didn't say a thing. When the alligator came on swimming by, still chewing on the future king. Lola jumped up, she grabbed that wand, said, Gator, son, this is the end. I'm about to walk all over this swamp on your big-ass alligator grin. You're gonna be the frog prince, don't you eat the spider's flies. His best friend is the old alligator, and he got hungry eyes. And if you're the gator, be careful, brother, which royal frog you choose. Cause if your lunch is Lola's, man, she's gonna turn you into shoes. Well, the moral to all this foolishness, simple, I suppose. When the world's going crazy all around you, take a lesson from Frog and Toad. When spiders and witches and gator son of a bitches are wasting time on royalty. Frog said ribbit and Toad said croak and they didn't bother you or me. And I'll be damned if for sure I am and I don't make too much sense. But when I die, I won't be alligator shoes with a little bit of frog prince. You're gonna be the frog prince, don't you eat the spider's flies. His best friend is the old alligator and he got hungry eyes. And if you're the gator, be careful, brother, which royal frog you choose. If your lunch is low, man, you're
you're gonna turn in is you. Yeah.
Yeah, man.
There's a little bit of foolishness there, really.
I love it.
That's my songwriter song. Songwriters love that song. It's just a bunch of nonsense.
Great voice, too.
Thanks, man. Thank you, Will. I appreciate you saying that.
No, man, I'm serious.
We'll get some more foolishness here in a little bit, but Derik Hultquist from Alcoa, Tennessee, brother. Tell us a little bit about growing up in East Tennessee and how you ended up in Nashville, man.
All right. So Alcoa was actually founded by my great-grandfather, I should say.
Okay.
He worked for Alcoa Aluminum Company. It's the namesake of that, for anybody unfamiliar with Alcoa Aluminum, it's the namesake of that town, you know. It'd be like if your town was called Pepsi or something, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up there and ended up in college in Kentucky and played sports in college. I played soccer, rather. So I ended up in Owensboro, Kentucky, and then came down here or to Nashville right after graduation, and I've been here ever since. It's going on, 14 some odd years now later.
Yeah, man.
So, yeah, I'm still here.
Hey, we're glad. That's a, I mean, that's an accomplishment. Not everybody who comes here and is still here, you know?
I'm here in spirit. If I'm not, the days I'm not. So, but yeah, it's been good. I ended up at Carnival Music.
Mm-hmm. That's where you and I met, I believe.
I believe so. Yeah, and it's owned by a guy named Frank Liddell, and Frank is a prince of a man. You know, he got his start at Decca. I think he was A&R at Decca, and then started Carnival in the '90s. And he's a real song guy. I mean, a real song guy. And he and I have worked together on we've done some sides and they're nice enough they give you long enough rope for you to hang yourself with. But
tell our audience what a side is, just so in case they're...
So we made a record in Nashville parlance, cutting sides is, you know, recording. And we've done that. And Frank is a hell of a producer.
Yeah.
You know, he's worked with all kinds of folks, and from Leanne to Miranda to, you name it, Brandi Carlile. And I trust his judgment about as much as anybody's musically, and he really looks for something unique.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Which I admire. I admire him. He sticks to his guns, you know. And it's a family atmosphere over there, you know, and I'm very, very lucky to be involved, you know.
Well, I'd say they're lucky to have you, man, and you fit in. The Carnival is a really cool place, and they do definitely keep folks around who are song-oriented, which seems to, you know, that ought to be how everybody is from the outside looking in, but oftentimes that's not necessarily the case, and you guys have a cool group of folks over there for sure, man.
Most definitely, man.
What you gonna play for us now, man?
That's a good. I was hoping my guitar was in tune. I was trying to sneak that tune in, the tuning in before.
Go for it, man.
But this is I changed the name of this song. This is a song called "Jason's in Drug Court," and I knew you were asking earlier about. I try not to talk about the songs because I don't think I did. I do them justice, you know. But I was when you asked that earlier about, you know, the nature of some of the backstory or whatever, some of these characters, I like to write characters, and I think totally. I gravitate towards ones that don't have redeeming qualities, right? You know, we are so familiar, we're so used to, like, happy endings.
Those are the most interesting.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, exactly, yeah. Right? I think you could tell a story, and you can let the listener to figure out what to pull from it, right?
Totally.
My old man, if he's out there listening, which I'm sure he is, he said that, you know, everybody's got a story, you know, and he also said, don't let the truth get in the way of telling a good one.
it's like no one wants to listen to a preacher that hasn't done some good sinning,
right? That's,
you know?
Right. Yeah, sure. That's right.
Well, it's a safe place here. I mean, guys, I just played a song about amphibians and reptiles and witches and spiders. So, what, you know, as long as people, you're in good shape, brother.
Yeah, that's a good point. Oh, man. Well, yeah, I'll give it a go if it
yes, sir.
If it works.
Hey, that's why you're here, man.
Here we go.
Jason's in Durco, trying to get the charges dropped. You get what you pay for, now he's paying for what he got. First thing he heard about when he came to, in a 10x4 two-bed, one-door gray-coated concrete room, life is short, not sweet if you're poor. I think what's in store might stink. Mix your blood with kerosene. Life is short, not sweet, I'm sure. I think you ought to have someone you need. But I got no one but me. I got no one but me. Ashes in the ashtray, ashtrays on the floor. It's been 2 months since he worked, and that long since he knew what he's working for. Crazy abstract drawings on free posted notes, and slow southern drawings coming from his throat. Simple math will tell you some of us are doomed. 'Cause the credit cards and the mini bars, they don't make it down to you. Life is short, not sweet if you're poor. I think what's in store might stink. Mix your blood with kerosene. Life is short, not sweet, I'm sure. I think you ought to have someone you need. But I got no one but me. I got no one but me. Death-defying legends of the fall, and obsolete technology littered down the hall. Simple acts of kindness violently undone, and a slow parade of blindness beneath the southern sun. Life is short, not sweet if you're poor, I think. What's in the store might stink. Mix your blood with kerosene. Life is sure, not sweet, I am sure. I think you ought to have someone you need. But I got no one but me. I got no one but me.
Yeah, buddy. Man, I love the imagery, man.
Thank you.
That's good stuff. Obsolete technology. I'm into it. That's good stuff. Beautiful, beautiful, man. Appreciate you being here, Derik.
I'm glad to be here. This is pure vodka, by the way.
There you go.
I don't want anybody to think we're not trying to get that Starbucks sponsorship, are we?
No. I mean, we'll take it. You know? Whatever works, man. We'll take it. Wil Nance, man from Missouri, correct? Am I correct in that?
You're right. Yep.
Draw me a line from Missouri to Nashville to wherever in Texas you met George Strait and got all that stuff going on, man.
Well, you know, I left Missouri in 1985 and went to Cincinnati, Ohio. A guitar player, a buddy of mine, had moved there. We played in a band in St. Louis together, and I went up to Cincinnati to front the band up there for him. I was there 2 years. Met my first wife there. We got married in August of 87, and I moved to Nashville in November of 87. And I tell you what, I was actually standing at Lefty's Tavern, a bar in Cincinnati, with my buddy Tom Brink, and he went over and played the jukebox. I remember hearing the song called Nobody's Right Mind Would Have Left Her. And Strait had cut the song, but it wasn't George Strait singing it. And I said, who's singing that? And he said, that's Dean Dillon, George. That's the guy who wrote the song. Mm. And I go, oh, dude, man, that is just wow. And I looked at him and I go, I'm out of here. I'm moving to Nashville. I said, I want to go try to do that. So I moved to Nashville, and that was in 87. And ironically enough, you know, I had a buddy that wrote for Irvin, Connie Woolsey, who managed George. And I hung out over there when I first moved to town. And I always wanted to be on a George Strait record. Well, I wanted to write with Dean Dillon. Of course, Dean was Dean, and he was rocking when I got here. But 8.5 years later, me and my first wife got divorced, and I thought I'd been here forever at 8.5 years. Looking back, it wasn't that long at all, but I remember going out in the deck of my apartment I just moved into. We'd sold the house we lived in, and I screamed at God, and I go, if I'm supposed to be here, you better make something happen, because I had two boys. They were 5 and 2 at the time, and she moved them back to Ohio, and I thought, man, what am I doing here? And George Strait cut this next song I'm going to play. And
yeah, buddy.
It's just kind of, I came full circle almost. It's like, wow, man, you know. And I remember when I heard he cut this, there was an old songwriter by the name of Harlan Howard, you know, that was writing songs when I moved here. He wrote I Fall to Pieces for Patsy Cline, Busted for Ray Charles. And I remember I was talking to Harlan one day, and he goes, you trying to be a songwriter, kid? Called everybody kid. I go, I'm trying, Harlan. He goes, get divorced a couple of times. That's a rough way to go, though, man. You know?
I'm going to try to skip that one if I can help it.
I seen that documentary on Dean Dillon. I was telling Derek earlier, and part of that documentary, Dean goes, man, it was a Nashville thing. We used to try to get the guys that had just been through a divorce, and that's who you wanted to write with, because that heart was just bleeding, he said.
Yeah.
But George cut this song, and I wrote this with my buddy Steve Dean. It was number one for a couple of weeks back in 1998. And see if I can do it here. As far as all my friends can tell, I took her leaving. Well, that's kind of right. When I'm out with them, I don't let her memory rule the night. Yeah, for the most part, I'm okay. Oh, but I still miss her in a roundabout way. Yeah, round about the time that midnight rolls around. That's around about the time my tears start falling down. Oh, cause she's not around. Yeah, when I come unwound and my heart breaks, because I still miss her in a roundabout way. Fiddles. Did you bring your fiddle down?
I didn't.
Hey, I no longer sit alone for hours by the phone, wishing she would call. Hey, and just the other day, I took her smiling face down off the wall. I've come a long, long way. Oh, but I still miss her in a roundabout way. Yeah, round about the time that midnight rolls around.
dance around about the time my tears start falling down. Oh, cause she's not around. Yeah, when I come unwound and my heart breaks because I still miss her in a roundabout way. Yeah, I still miss her in a roundabout way.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. That's one y'all probably heard a couple dozen times in your life, at least. Man, great song, man. And
thank you, man.
I'll say this, Will. Somebody like me, at least, who's still looking for that big song or whatever it is and still chasing this thing. We're all still chasing it, but some of us a little further behind than others. I can get by for 6 months off of hearing somebody like you has sat there and screamed out into the night, what am I doing here?
I thought about maybe using that same technique after he said it.
You know what I mean?
I haven't tried that.
Well, it's a good kind of angry. You
yeah,
know
totally.
But you got to get, when you're passionate about something, you want to, you know, it's okay to get a little mad and get a little frustrated, you know.
Well, I just appreciate hearing you say that because that
man,
it helps me out to hear something. It ain't just me, you know. It's bad to feel like you're the only lonely one out there. It's nice to know there are others from time to time too. Me. I guess that makes it my turn, doesn't it? I've been here in Nashville. I've lived here for, gosh, about 5 years now. Has it been that long? Wow.
Did you move straight from Chattanooga to here?
So I lived in Knoxville for about 18 years, Derek.
That's right. Okay.
I went to UT and then lived there for a while and got laid off of my last real job in 2008 in December when there weren't any other jobs out there. Mm-hmm. And I just started a little band and started writing songs and happened to meet a guy who was a little bit connected in Nashville. And he said, you know, you can do this. Like, this is a job you can pursue for a living. And I was like, get out of here, man. You're full of shit. And I lived off of that little bit of, you know, that got me by for a year at least, going, all right, if you can do this, then I'm going to sit here and write. He told me, he was like, a real songwriter, you have to have written 100 songs or so. How many have you written? I said, probably 20 or so. I'd probably written 6, you know. Just right. Lying.
Round
just,
it up.
Just lying. Yeah. Round him way up. And so I went back home and I wrote and wrote and wrote and wrote and called him back up. And we sat around and picked some tunes and took me with him to Nashville. And I was hooked, man. I started commuting a couple days a week. A guy named Channing Wilson and I shared a little office on 18th when you could still afford to share an office on 18th Street. And I would come up here. I'd sleep on the couch. And then I'd play a show for college over at Tennessee Tech in Cookeville on the way back to Knoxville on every Tuesday. And I did that for 5 years every week. And it was, and then we decided we're going to move on out here. And it's been the best thing, man. It's the place to be for doing what we do. But anyhow, this is a song I did write this in Knoxville. And when I first started coming and playing songs in Nashville, it took a while to kind of find, you know, where I fit in and what's, I'm just kind of figuring out what songs to play. And I wrote this song called $3 Wine. I started playing it out and that was the first song that got me any kind of attention around town. This is the other song I wrote the same day that I wrote $3 Wine. And when I first wrote them, this is the one I liked better to begin with. But anyhow, I'd been listening to Merle Haggard when I wrote this song, as one does. It was like this. There's four walls all around me, three of concrete and one of bars. 7 months of Sunday since I've seen the moon and stars. There's a hole in the ceiling, cracking the cold, cold floor. Guys, I gotta start over. I can't even find the right melody. There it is. It's lower. Good. I'm trying to sing it too high. One more time. I got four walls all around me, three of concrete and one of bars. 7 months of Sunday since I've seen the moon and stars. There's a hole in the ceiling, a crack in the cold, cold floor. They got a Bible man for praying. Ain't got nothing to pray for. When they turned the key behind me, they left me with my shame. Now I'm stranded here for 10 more years with a number for my name. Each night I lie here dreaming in the bed that I made, just to wake up in the morning to a debt that I can't pay. They let me out tomorrow or 10 years down the line, I'd be gone from this prison, but I'd still be doing time. I leave here on that morning, no more sin to blame. I'll find myself a free man with a number for my name. Regret is just a memory. Guilt is handed down. Sorry is just something said so we can't hear the sound. Man ain't made of nothing more than flesh and blood and bone, and all he'll leave behind him is a name upon a stone. They say I'll find redemption, wish that I could say the same. When they look at me, all they'll ever see is a number from my name. Take these shackles from me, but they'll leave me here in chains, and what's left of a lifetime with a number for my name.
Yeah.
Man, it's been a while since I played that one, guys. That's a...
Yeah,
you're gonna have to save me, Derik. I couldn't find the melody on that at all, man. Woo! I'll jazz to y'all out there. I'll just play $3 wine next time. Dang.
Well, you shouldn't have said nothing. It sounded fine to us. We don't know what the melody is.
That's right. That's the one nice thing about, you know, not having all the Wil Nance cuts. Is I can play them however the hell I want to.
I used to say that when I was playing shows. I'd be like, "This is a new one," and then I'd go, "Well, that doesn't matter."
Right?
You know what the old ones are.
I hear you, buddy. Well, Derik, man, so I think you told me beforehand, so you're working on some new music right now, is that correct?
We are, yeah.
With Frank, you know, again?
With Frank Liddell, right. And Eric Masse, and some really cool players, and it's just been, you know, we started probably 2.5 years ago, and it's just like with the pandemic and everything, it was just a shit show. Yeah.
That's cool. You're over there with some real song people, and they are real song.
Yeah, they
people.
Are.
Frank Liddell's always been a song guy.
He is, you know, he's a slow. He doesn't rush. You know what I mean? And so that's part of it too. Just taking our time, and yeah, that's been awesome. But it's been arrested, you know, at times because of the whole. You know, it goes without saying everything going on.
Yeah, you almost don't even want to talk about it anymore.
I know it. I'm just so sick of talking about it.
Yeah, it's almost become cliche to even mention.
I know. COVID. It's like the weather. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But yeah, but doing that, you know, I'm still trying to write as much as I can. I try to take a workmanlike approach to it. You know what I mean? But I think we all agree that it comes in stages. You know, when it's when it's really coming, right. I was thinking about playing a tune. I don't know. Will and I were talking about, you know, I told him I've been here for 14 years, and he's been here longer than I have. But I do kind of think that it's a badge of honor. You know, sometimes when you're talking, especially Nashville music people, it's like, how long you been here? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like stripes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I'm getting to where I hate to tell him how long.
Yeah, right.
Because then they know how old I am.
Oh, shoot. I mean, if I had your track record, I wouldn't worry about telling anybody anything, right. Frankly. But it is something, you know, at this stage for me, I'm very proud of it, you know, especially like I was saying earlier, I paid $200 my first rent. I was like, you can't get shit for $200 anymore except for a sandwich and some blue jeans.
Yeah, totally.
But no, this tune is a little bit about, you know, I don't know if you guys can relate, but there are situations where that thing that pushes you to keep doing this thing, it puts some strain on, you know, on lots of things, relationships and otherwise, you know, and that's that's what this tune was about, more or less. And it's called One Horse Town.
All right.
Gave my heart my last name, played my part in the pouring rain. Yes, I waited too long for the sun to go down. Ain't it hard to be a hero in a one-horse town? When she says, baby, tell me why you wait so long. When she says, baby, tell me why you wait so long. I don't know what I did, but I tried my luck. Yeah, I used to be a kid who didn't give up much. But now I'm just as old as the Lord allows. Oh, and ain't it hard to be a hero in a one-horse town? When she says, baby, tell me why you wait so long. When she says, baby, tell me why you wait so long, so long. And I spent half my life in a parking lot. Half my time getting what I got. I seen the boxer and the lawyer go one more round. Yeah, but ain't it hard to be a hero in a one-horse town? Yeah, ain't it hard to be a hero in a one-horse town? Oh, when she says, baby, tell me why you wait so long. When she says, baby, tell me why you wait so long, so long. I gave my heart and my last name, and I played my part in a pouring rain. Yes, and I waited too long for the sun to go down. Oh, but ain't it hard to be a hero in a one-horse town? Ain't it hard to be a hero in a one-horse town?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, that's good stuff.
Thank you.
That's good. So that's Derik Hultquist, y'all. And make sure you're on the on the lookout. He's got new music coming out. He's got old music you can get now. So make sure you get out, go get that old music and pay for it, and then stream it on top of that is what we tell everybody to do out here. We like to get them coming and going, buddy, best we can. Wil Nance, I'm sitting here. I'm sitting here thinking, like, you know, what are we going to talk about now? And I don't want you giving away all your secrets or anything. I feel like that's not, you know.
Oh, I ain't got
well, we're going to do that off camera, though. You know,
yeah.
Way to the rest of the world. But I tell you, man, I really just tell us what you're going to play, and I want to hear the story behind the song, man. At this point,
you know, you say secrets. You know, it's funny. It's like. Well, I've never been flavor of the month, of course, in this town, you know, like a lot of guys are, and great for them, but I've always felt like I've been trying to, like, had to prove myself, and that's okay, because I wake up, and, I mean, it's all about the next song I write, you know, and it's funny, because back in 2002, I was out looking for somebody to pay me to write songs for them, and I met with this big publisher here in town. And I played him 5 songs at that meeting that day, and they were all co-written, you know. And he looked at me and he said at the end of the 5 song meeting, he said, "Man, Willie," said, "I can tell you, I can hear you in all these songs." He goes, "I know you can write songs." He goes, "But do me a favor, go home and write a song by yourself, and I'll think about signing you," because he was wanting guys that could write 100%ers. And I think he's just wanting to make more money.
Surely not.
But anyway, so I went home and I went up in my music room and I thought, I got to write a song for this guy. So I started thinking about a song to write and started thinking about my wife that I'm still married to. And by the way, I'm married. I got a 30-year-old now. I got a 27-year-old, those boys that were kids back then. And then I got an 11-year-old. You know, who the man, you know.
I heard that.
Me and Mick Jagger, you know, just keep having kids. But so I wrote a song about Holly, my wife, and it took me about 2 weeks to write it. I think when you write by yourself, you got to be a little schizophrenic or something. I don't know. Anyway, I called him back up, and he said, "Man, I ain't got time to meet with you again. Drop it off." And I listened to it. I dropped the song off, never heard another word from him. I thought it was a pretty good song, so I made a demo of it, pitched it around town a little bit. I think John Michael Montgomery put it on hold, Craig Morgan, a group named Diamond Rio. Mm-hmm. And then I was finally writing with Chris Dubois one day, a buddy of mine who works with Brad Paisley, and I played him the song. I said, "Chris, let me play you something." I picked up my guitar and I played him the song. He goes, "Will, I love it." He said, "Can I play it for Brad?" I said, "Sure." So he plays it for Brad. About 5 months goes by, I get this call from Chris. He goes, "Hey, man, Brad has never done this before. He's digging the song you wrote. And he's never done this, but if he's going to sing it in front of 20,000 people, he wants to change a few of the words and make it more about his wife." And I laughed. I said, "You tell Paisley I don't want him singing about my wife in front of that many people. Sing about your own dang wife." So,
that's right.
So it ended up being a song about two wives.
There you go.
Big in Utah, two wives.
Hey-o.
But I'll play you, this is what Brad heard when he heard the song for the first time. And you ask me, who is she? That's a list a mile long. She's a red pair of tennis shoes, a holy pair of jeans. She's a pair of cool sunglasses. She's a sexy little thing. She says, "I want a piece of chocolate. Take me to a movie." She says, "I can't find a thing to wear. Every now and then she's moody. She's a ragtop libertine with her auburn hair blowing. She's a soft place to land, a good feeling knowing. She's a warm conversation I wouldn't miss for nothing. She's a fighter when she's mad. She's a lover when she's loving. She's a night out on the town. She's a choir girl on Sunday. She's a cross around her neck. And her working girl come Monday. She's a bubble bath and candles. Baby, come and kiss me. She's a one glass of wine. And she's feeling kind of tipsy. And she's everything to me. You ask me, who is she? That's a list a mile long. I'll tell you about her and go on and on and on. She's a window to my soul. She's my warmth under the covers. A picture that I carry. She's my unborn children's mother. She's a hand that I'm holding when I'm on my knees and praying. She's the answer to my prayers. She's the song that I'm playing. She's a voice I love to hear. Oh, and someday when I'm 90, she's that wooden rocking chair. I want a rocking rap to shine. She's all of that and then some. Here's just one thing more. She's the one I laid down my own life for. And she's everything to me. You ask me, who is she? That's a list a mile long. And she's everything I've ever wanted, everything I need. I talk about her, I go on and on and on. Cause she's everything to me.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. Brad Paisley was a, he made a good decision right there, buddy. It's a smart move, in my opinion. One humble man. Love songs are not always the easiest thing in the world to write, at least not to me. I don't know why I struggle with that, but at least,
well,
for me.
It's hard to make them not cheesy.
Totally. Exactly.
I was there when Brad cut that song that day. He invited me. It's funny, he called me up the day before. He said, "Hey, Will, it's Brad Paisley." He goes, "I'm cutting your song tomorrow." He said, "And I want you there." He said, "I'm not going to listen to nothing you say." He said, "But I want you there." You know, Brad, he's pretty funny. So I showed up over there, and I never will forget, after he cut that song, Frank Rogers, the producer, he hit the talk button. I mean, they tracked it about eight times before they finally go, "That's it." He hit the talk button. He goes, "Well, Brad, you finally got you a love song that's not cheesy."
Yeah.
And so, you know, I don't know.
All my love songs turn out sad for whatever reason. I write the sad love songs, but I tell you what, I'm gonna play one now. My wife did help inspire this song. It's a song that I wrote the same day that I wrote that other song that I butchered a while ago. So we're gonna play it, and it's gonna come out better. But I wrote this song. It's called $3 Wine, and I wrote it after talking to my wife one day. She had a friend. We were living in Knoxville at the time. It was before we sold wine in grocery stores in Tennessee. And she had a friend out and coming back from North Carolina or something. It was like, "You need anything?" While somehow that came up conversation that she was stopping by Trader Joe's.
Oh, $2 Chuck.
And Kate said, "Give me a case of that $2 Chuck." I had no idea what she was talking about. I said, "What the hell are you talking about?" And she said, my wife is wonderful and smart and beautiful and incredible and also the biggest tightwad on the planet. She's probably listening right now. And she would agree with that. She's the cheapest woman that ever walked the face of the earth. And I love her for it because I've always been too poor to be able to have any money to spend on anything. So Valentine's Day for us was going and buying a bunch of Taco Bell and watching Netflix for a long time. So exactly, man. It's perfect. But anyhow, she's talking about the $2 Chuck, and I said, shit, only wine I ever had that was cheap was Mad Dog 2020 in college when I couldn't afford anything else. And I was like, well, maybe I will write a song about that. I felt like $3 wine sounded better than $2 wine. So visit goes like this. Memories linger on, just like prisoners in time. With sin to atone, shackled here in my mind. Oh, but since you've been gone, every night seems to find me hanging round here, drowning each tear in $3 wine. $3 wine, so bitter and strong, just like fruit on the vine. I keep hanging on, 'cause it helps me get high. Hurts every time. Still, I can't get enough. Darling, we've got a love like $3 wine. Don't it go down so hard? And it burns just like hell. It will tear you apart, leave you right where you fell. They say it's good for the heart, Lord, but how it broke mine. Like the biggest fool around, I keep drinking you down like $3 wine. $3 wine, so bitter and strong, just like fruit on the vine. Still, I can't get enough. Baby, we've got love like $3 wine. No, I can't get enough. Honey, we've got love like $3 wine.
Yeah, man. Love it.
That's a song about Mad Dog 2020.
I love it.
Country. That's the sponsorship you need right there.
That's right.
It's country, too.
Thanks, man. A good waltz every now and again is good for the soul, if you ask me.
I agree.
But, I'm going to go relieve myself. I'll be right back.
We appreciate that, Will. We like to keep our artists comfortable as we can around here on Southern Rounds, folks. Derik, man, just tell me about what you're going to play next, man. You guys have been, This is I love the shows where I don't really have to do a whole lot of work. I mean, I didn't really get into playing music and writing songs because I liked working hard. So
that's a good point. You know Rob Snyder, right?
I know Rob Snyder very well.
Rob said one time this dude was. To give you a glimpse for the folks at home how the sausage is made. Rob was talking about one time this dude had a write with him. I guess it was at 10 a.m., which is already a no-no because, you don't start till before 11. And Rob was like 15 minutes late, and this guy was blowing him up. And I hope I'm doing this story justice. And this guy's blowing him up because he's 15 minutes late. And Rob finally gets back to him and goes, "Hey, man. If I wanted to work for a living, I would have got a different job. I'll be there in a minute."
Yeah, that's Snyder. Rob Snyder is a Southern Rounds veteran and one of the best friends anybody could have in Nashville, man. He's just a good guy, an advocate for songwriters and for good songs and good music, and we love him here on Southern Rounds, man. But no, you guys have done such a good job of just like, sometimes folks get on here and I've got to pull stuff out of them, man. I'm just kind of turn the reins loose to y'all and let you do your thing. It's almost like y'all have done writer's round before.
That may backfire.
You got it, buddy. But yeah, tell us a little, tell us what you're going to play next and give us, give us a story behind it, man.
I don't know if there is a story behind it, but this is, do you
remember? The one in front of it's fine too.
Do you know who, it's a Canadian, Gordon Lightfoot. Do you know who that is?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald, man.
That's funny you said it. So this is a tune. It's like a story song, right?
Yeah.
I like story songs, and that's the closest thing to something like that I could get away with. It's called The Bounty. It's another character-based, tune. And I wrote it not too long ago. We cut some sides. There it is again. I had this joke the other day. I thought about putting out a record called B-Sides, and it's just a concept album about apiary culture. Well, I'll use that next time. Anyway, what was I going to say? I wrote this out because I spend a lot of time. My girlfriend lives in Oklahoma City, and so I spend a lot of time out there, and I wrote this tune out there. I just got a little back porch, and the wind was right, and we ended up cutting some sides in Tulsa, which is about an hour and a half north of Oklahoma City, so that was and we cut this one. That was a cool opportunity to get out and meet some different musical minds and do that, but this is another one of those three-four deals. So
love it.
Anyway, I won't bore you. It goes like this. Somebody somewhere told me that I should have never done what I did. But I didn't listen. I was on a mission. I was just a scared little kid. The heart doesn't break, no, it's different than that. It cracks up slow over time. How do I know? Can't you see the glow leaking out of the cracks there in my eyes? But I soldier on, no rest shall I have till the demons inside me subside. Like a highway of bones laid out tooth to toe, my memory is buried alive. I paid the bounty $2,000 to the Mountie who let me pass by under wraps. I told him if I was alive this time next year, I'd surely be back. Next year, I'll surely be. Theirs isn't much weather stuck to the leather of the soul as out on the plains. Canadian chains, they
Slip off the reins and pile up beneath your shoestrings. Somebody somewhere told me that I should have never done what I did. But I didn't listen. I was on a mission. I was just a scared little kid. Well, the heart doesn't break, no, it's different than that. It cracks up slow over time. How do I know? Can't you see the glow leaking out of the cracks there? In my eyes. In my
eyes. Yeah.
That's good stuff, man. That's good stuff. We got folks tuning in from all over the place right now listening to you guys, man. From, I guess we're broadcasting on Facebook and YouTube and Instagram Live. We got folks from West Virginia, from Charleston, from Chattanooga, New York City, Nashville, Austin, Tyler, Exeter, New Hampshire, upstate New York, Virginia Beach, Charleston again. Maybe that's the other Charleston. Atlanta, y'all, we appreciate everybody tuning in and spending a Wednesday evening with us out here. Make sure wherever you're at, you're following At Southern Rounds Live. If you're on YouTube, make sure you click the subscribe link on there so that we can keep you up to date with all of our, with each show's roster and all kinds of other content that we've got coming at you.
Do y'all go every week?
Say that again?
Do y'all go every week?
We're every other week. We're every other week right now. And hoping before long to bring the show out and actually on the road and play in front of real live people instead of their avatars for a while.
Yeah.
I know, right? So hopefully we'll be able to call on some of you guys to come out on the road with us too, man. We always have a good time, and it's a good time to write songs and play songs and just kind of be somewhere other than the house, man.
Well, you're right. We had some, I had some shows that got recent. We were supposed to play this month and be on the road for a week and a half or so, and those all got, for this, that, or the other reason, got rescheduled. And
yeah.
But hopefully they will be out in March.
I think we're coming out. I think this spring we're coming back out, and I think it's going to be in full force. It's going to be a lot of fun.
I hope so.
And I hope that, you know, by the next time that I'm cutting songs that I've got a Wil Nance cut on mine, because he writes awesome songs. So
you're right, yeah.
That's my shameless plug to try to get a co-write.
And he's a good guitar player too.
All right.
Oh man, I'm struggling here. I'm struggling.
No way, man.
I told him earlier he played a diminished chord. That's you get paid extra for that.
Well, buddy, I played a song in B minor earlier and sang it in C minor. So you know,
that takes talent.
That was some kind of weird backwoods jazz or something I was trying to pull off over here. So whatever you got, I'm sure is going to crush that, man.
You know, the hardest thing I think about writing songs is trying to figure out what to write about.
Totally.
You ever sit in cold stare with people?
Oh, yeah.
Just look at them and go, you got anything? I ain't got nothing. But I was writing with Chris Jansen and Kelly, his wife, one morning, and Kelly came in and she pulled up two blonde-haired sisters on Facebook, a picture of them, and started telling me and Chris the story behind the picture. And their dad was terminally ill, and before he passed away, he made one final request to his daughters. And when she told us what it was, we said, there's your song idea. Believe it or not, Steven Tyler put this song on hold, and I really couldn't hear Steven doing it. But then Tim McGraw heard it, and he cut it. It didn't make the record. And then Chris put it on his last record. And then I just found out about 2 weeks ago, Joe Nichols just cut this song. And
song's lived a fuller life than I have, it sounds like.
Well, it has. It ain't been a hit yet, and I don't know if it will be, but I sang the song at a few funerals and stuff already. I've lost my brother about 2 years ago. He liked this song.
Sorry to hear that, man.
Yeah, man.
I'm glad he got to hear it, though.
Yeah. Someday when I die, you're gonna cry. Yeah, hopefully I'll be on up in the sky. No, don't spend my money on a box and a home. It might be my body, but that ain't my soul. Put your feet in the sand, buy you a Coke, raise it on up, crack a good joke. Tiptoes in the water, ashes to see. When I die, go to Hawaii on. Have the time of your life. Go on and blow it on. Derek, throw a big party in a big penthouse overlooking the bay of Waikiki. Yeah, when I die, go to Hawaii on me. Put your feet in the sand, buy you a Coke, raise it on up, crack a good joke. Tiptoes in the water, ashes to see. When I die, go to Hawaii. I made a good living, I've lived a good life. I raised some good kids, I've loved a good wife. So get on that plane in a first class seat. Yeah, when I die, go to Hawaii on me. Put your feet in the sand, buy you a Coke, raise it on up, crack a good joke. Toes in the water, ashes to see. When I die, go to Hawaii on me. When I die, go to Hawaii on me.
You're here.
Yeah, man. What I'm talking about. Beautiful, 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 man. We once again appreciate you guys being here. I tell you what we're going to do. We've got just enough time left. I'm going to do one more, and then I'm going to let you guys, just the two of you, take it home. Each play one more tune, and we'll get out of here. But man, thank you guys so much for being here.
Thank you, David.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you to everybody who's tuned in and watching. We'll be back in 2 weeks on February 9th, and we'll announce that lineup here shortly. So if you guys, anybody who's new out there, we hope you'll tune back in and check us out, because we love to showcase our friends and our and super talented songwriters. And I'll tell you what, I'm gonna play a story song. Derik, you inspired me.
Oh shit.
I wrote this song years ago. It's probably when I mentioned those first batches of songs that I furiously wrote a while back. This was in that, and it's one of my favorites still. It goes like this. When I left home, I was 17 years old. I had an angel's smile and a fool's heart of gold. Mr. Lincoln called me off to war to kill boys I'd never met before. Through days of fire, nights dark and cold. They gave me a rifle and a brand new pair of shoes. And an overcoat of brass and Union blue. taught me how to march in line and said, leave no wounded man behind. And I don't Charlie sing us a song too. He sang when Johnny comes marching home again, but his song's lost on a hickory wind in the flames that burn from Georgia to Carolina. Well, I got family in Alabama, but my soul's bought by Uncle Sam for a rifle and a belly full of Union wine. I met Annie in 1862. At a church house beneath an April moon, I asked her to marry me beneath an old magnolia tree. She said, only if I come back too soon. I left her there in Shenandoah in a dress of springtime calico. She wiped the tears away the back of her left hand. I said, forget me not if I should fall, and should I come again to call, I'll bring you a golden wedding band. Lord, tonight watch over me, I pray. I fear I shall not see the light of day. Them rebel boys surrounded me somewhere here in Tennessee, while Annie sleeps alone so far away. I cried when Johnny comes marching home again, but my song was lost on a hickory wind as the angels' bells in heaven began to chime. Annie, please remember me as I die beneath this old pine tree with my rifle and a belly full of Union wine. Annie, please remember me as I die beneath this old pine tree with my rifle and a belly full of Union wine.
Yeah,
oh, it's just an old wannabe folk song, you know.
That's great.
Thanks, man. I always like that one a whole lot. But I'll tell you what, man, I'm gonna turn it over to y'all. We got enough time for each of you to do a song, so we're gonna speed around this one. I'm gonna get out of the way and let you guys take it over.
Okay,
we'll start with Mr. Hultquist, man.
Yes, sir. Let me see it. This one might be a little louder on the guitar. We'll see.
I'm into that.
Pull me down in the mix, man. I'm a 1-6 man. And I lost confidence a long time ago. I'm closing in on 36, man. Then again, ain't that part of the plan? You can't drive a passenger van forever. To all the girls I left behind on all those nights, I couldn't stay sober. With every year that passes by, I move that cable a little bit lower. Is it too soon for you and I to start over? I treat my life like a rainbow. A little sun, a little rain, though. And I can't seem to put the brakes on a beautiful goodbye. I'm a cartoon and a cowboy. I'm the last swing in that baseball bat. Two quotation marks that don't know where they're at, I suppose. To all the girls I left behind on all those nights, I couldn't stay sober. With every year that passes by, I move that cable a little bit lower. Is it too soon for you and I to start over? Well, Christmas came early this year. I had myself a bitter beer. I got my health and my old fears intact. I need a couch and a cigarette. One for the doubt, one for the regret, one for the drink that I ain't had yet. Lord, I will. So pull me down in the mix, man. I'm a 1-6 man. And I lost confidence a long time ago. To all the girls I left behind on all those nights, I couldn't stay sober. With every year that passes by, I move that capo a little bit lower. Is it too soon for you and I to start over?
That's Derik Hultquist, y'all. Go pick up Southern Iron and be paying attention for his for new music coming out soon. And if you're looking for Wil Nance songs, just turn on your radio anytime. And you'll hear,
you'll hear a couple dozen.
Yeah.
Right.
Guys, we thank y'all so much for being here. And Will, if you would just take us on home, I would.
I'd love a little song that George Strait's got a son named Bubba, and Bubba came to town to write some songs. And me and Bubba and Bob Regan wrote this song, and Bubba went back to San Antonio. I called him the next morning. I said, "Hey, Bubba, I sent you that song. You could use another verse. Tell your dad to write a verse to it if he wants to." So about a year and a half went by, and Bubba called me one day. He goes, "Hey, Will, you remember that song we wrote, blah, blah, blah?" I go, "Yeah." He goes, "Did you tell me to tell my dad to write on it?" I go, "Yeah." He goes, "Well, he thinks he's a songwriter on it." I said, "Well, tell him he is, and no one sings that Western swing stuff better than George Strait."
Right.
To get in there and sing it. So he sang this song, and he came to Nashville and did a had a listening party for all the writers on the record, and you got to sit right next to George Strait while your song was being played. And I never heard the verse George wrote until he was sitting right next to me. Hell, I had to like it. He was sitting right there.
Right.
You know,
that's a test of a poker face.
Too late
right
for
there.
Suggestions.
Right? No, but it made me laugh.
Absolutely.
But the fiddles went, I some got a boat they like to float. Some got a store they sugar coat. Some got a clue and then some don't. It takes all kinds. Some got a beer they like to drink. Some got a thought they like to think. Some got a chain with a few more links. It takes all kinds. That's what makes this world go round. You keep doing your thing. I'll be doing mine right now. You got a song, go on and sing it. Crank it up, rip back and bring it. I got one, I think I'll swing it. It takes all kinds. Swing it, boy. Where's your fiddle at? Somewhere a backwards baseball cap. If that's you, I'm cool with that. Me, I'm more a cowboy hat. It takes all kinds. That's what makes this world go round. You keep doing your thing. I'm doing mine right now. You got a song, go on and sing it. Crank it up, bring it back and bring it. I got one, I think I'll swing it. It takes all kinds. All right, you ready for George's verse?
Let's hear it.
It's Texas poetry now, okay? See if I can remember it. Some like a dip in their bottom lip. They say it's easier to spit. Me, I like a top lip dip. It takes all kinds. If that's what makes this world go round, you keep doing your thing. I'm doing mine right now. Some say it is, some say it ain't. Some say we can, some say we can't. Winners, losers, sinners, saints. It takes all kinds. Some got a boat they like to float. Some got a story they sugarcoat. Some got a beer they like to drink. Some got a thought they like to think. Some got a chain with a few more links. It takes all kinds, yeah.
Yeah. Well, if there was ever a theme to Southern Rounds, that's it right there, because it takes all kinds to keep this ship moving in the right direction, y'all. But Derik Hultquist, Wil Nance, thank you guys so much for being here.
Thank you, my friend.
Appreciate everybody from tuning in. We'll hope we'll see you in a couple weeks on February 9th, and be on the lookout for that lineup. I'm Dave Kennedy. Thank you, guys.
Awesome.